Hare Krishna. So, thank you for coming today, and I'll speak on the Bhagavad Gita's second chapter. Broadly, there are two kinds of people in the world. Some people are wise, and some are otherwise. So, the Bhagavad Gita is a guidebook which can help people to change from otherwise to wise. And the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita begins with a universal question. That universal question is, what are we meant to do in life? What are we to do? Arjun asks Krishna a defining question. Pruchhami tvam dharma sammoodha chetaha. Dharma sammoodha cheta. I do not know what I am to do. Dharma refers not just to some religious codes, but dharma refers to the right thing to do. Now, all of us have certain paths set for our life. Say, if we are students, then okay, we pass this grade and then go to next grade and next grade. That's the path set for us. If we have a job, okay, this is how our life gets oriented around the job. If we have a family, then our responsibilities are accordingly set for us. So normally, when we are going by one road, we don't think too much about which turn to take, as long as the road is straight. But once we come to an intersection, hey, should I go here or should I go there? So that's the time when confusion comes up. So similarly for us, sometimes life brings us to intersection points. Where should I do this or should I do that? We just don't know. And things can become very confusing at that time. Now, what should we do? That depends on, okay. So what should I do depends on who I think I am. So that means that suppose, say somebody is a judge in a court, and then they normally there are cases which come before them, the accused is brought in front of them, the plaintiff, complainant comes, and the judge hears the case. Now imagine if a situation is there where the judge's own son is there as an accused. Now at that time, what should the judge do? The judge knows in advance this case, the evidence is very strong against my son. Now if the judge identifies oneself primarily as a judge, then the judge will say that, no, I am a judge, I have to do my duty. I have to punish somebody who is a wrongdoer. But if the judge identifies as a father, says, it's my son, how can I send him to jail? I have to do what it takes to protect. So then in that time, of course, practically speaking, the judge would have to recuse. They will be told, you cannot judge a case like this because there is a conflict of interests. But if there were no alternative, then what the judge would do depends on who do we think we are. So the judge identifies with being a judge more than being with a father. The judge will say, no, let the person be punished. The judge identifies more with being a father than being a judge. Then the judge will say, then they will say that, I'll get my father, it's the son off the hook somehow or the other. So basically, at the start of the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna faces a similar conflict. There are different kinds of conflicts when we come to an intersection point. Say for example, today you came for a program. Now some of you had the option to do something else, but you chose to come for the program. So whether to come for not, that was a decision. It is an intersection and you chose in a particular way. Now that could depend on your interest, it could depend on your your plan for what you want to do in your, how you want to grow in your life, and you felt maybe this could help you learn something. So you, there is, we all have certain basis on which we make some decisions. And usually if we put a little bit of thought, we can arrive at an intelligent decision. But there are some situations which become very complex, where there is, like in this case, it's an ethical tension. Ethical tension means there are two courses of action and neither of them is clearly right or clearly wrong. So at that time, what do we do? So Arjuna had two duties pulling him. He had his Kula Dharma and he had his Kshatriya Dharma. His Kshatriya Dharma told him that you are a martial guardian of society, therefore you have a duty to punish the wrongdoers, whoever may be the wrongdoers, even if they are your relatives, even if they are your elders. But his Kula Dharma, he's a part of a dynasty, the Kuru dynasty, the Kula Dharma made him feel, how can I attack my, how can I cause the destruction of my own dynasty? That's not to be done. Whatever I gain by that, is it worth it? So his, by his reasoning, he comes to the conclusion initially that it's not worth it. But then he thinks, okay, if I don't fight, I won't kill my loved ones. But here also my loved ones are there, they will have to suffer. Either they will be killed, because the opponents are bent on war, or will be disgraced. And we will have to live in poverty in the forest, and these rulers are unjust. And they will do much more atrocities if they have no one to challenge them. So at this point, his question is, what is dharma? So two dharmas are pulling him to different directions. He's come to an intersection. And he asks, what should I do? Prichami tvam dharma sammuda chetaha. And now Krishna's answer, so this is a universal question. The specifics of some battle that happened 5,000 years ago may not seem relevant for us. But the Bhagavad Gita has been found relevant by millions for millennia because the question it addresses is, has very little to do with the specific historical context. The question it addresses is universal. So we could say the first section is there is a confusion about duty. And to get to resolve the confusion about duty, the first thing Krishna does is clarification of identity. As I said, what we should do is determined by who we are. Now, we can have various levels of identity. Say, for example, we might say that I am a male or a female. I'm an Indian. I'm an American. I'm a South Indian. I'm a North American. Whatever. So, if we consider our identities, we could frame them in different contexts. If we connect with our parents, we say, this is my surname, this is my name. So now, Krishna, so these are, we have various, what we could say, functional identities. Functional identity means in terms of the function that we do in life. So I might say, I'm a software engineer. That's my functional identity. Somebody might say, I'm a mother. That's my functional identity. Now the same person who says, I'm a mother or a father, before they had a child, they were not a mother or father. So based on a function, we might get an identity. Similarly, we can say that based on the kind of body that we have, which country, which I'm a short person, I'm a tall person, we have various identities. So Krishna says that below or underlying all these functional identities is our fundamental identity. And at the level of functional identities, there can be confusion. Einstein said that problems can't be solved at the same level of consciousness that created them. So Arjuna's confusion was, one level of functional identity is, I'm a Kuru Nandana. I'm a member of the Kuru dynasty. Another level of functional identity is, I'm a Kshatriya. I'm meant to fight against aggressors. So both are at the same level of consciousness. Because in both cases, he is identifying with his external physical situation. So Krishna says, below these two functional identities there is a fundamental identity. And that fundamental identity remains unchanging no matter how many functional identities change. We might say, I am Indian, but we might get American citizen, we become American. We might be a software professional, we might decide to become a professor. So we can change so many things. I was in Canada, I met one person. Person has changed his or her, whatever, his or her gender 6 times till now. There are people who change the gender, but 6 times has changed. Not this. So now, so we can change so many things about ourselves. But beyond all this, there is a fundamental identity which remains the same. And that identity is at the spiritual level. This comes from a fundamental level of I-ness. That I, who is the I who says, I am an Indian, I am an American. So we can see that the externals keep changing. Our roles in society keep changing. Our self-conceptions according to the role keep changing. But below that, the self remains the same. And that self is the soul. The soul or Atma, in the Bhagavad-gita says, that is who we essentially are. And Krishna says, if you understand yourself as the soul, that is where your growth in knowledge begins. And then what happens if we understand we are the souls? Basically, we go deeper into our own identification. I met somebody from Sri Lanka a few months ago, and they told me that actually one of their friends was a scuba diver, and this person had gone scuba diving on the same day or on the same morning when that deadly tsunami hit the Indian subcontinent, so Sri Lanka, India, Chennai and all those places. So this person had gone underwater for scuba diving, and suddenly he felt himself rising. He said, what happened? And then after that, it stopped. And he went down, did his scuba diving, and came back up, and he went back to the coastline, and there was no coastline. Because while they were underwater, while he was underwater, the tsunami had come, and the whole coastline had been swamped with water. So now the water destroyed those who were on the land. But who was in the water was unhurt. Because they had gone deep into the water. So similarly, at the surface level in our lives, many storms will come. So we might identify myself, somebody might identify themselves as a cricketer. I've just met somebody in Canada who came from India to Canada on a sports visa. They came as a cricketer to Canada. And then he was in the Canadian national team, and then once he was fielding and he fell on his shoulder and he had an injury, and that ended his cricket career. And as he left his country and come here, and that was the time somehow he was so depressed, but he met devotees, got a Bhagavad-gita, and that's how he understood. I thought I'm a cricketer, and now I can't be a cricketer, then who am I? Then he understood, actually I'm a soul. So then that gave him such relief. And now he's become a business person, and he travels across the world. And he's a very wonderful devotee speaker and leader of a community there. So the point is that sometimes the whole identity which we have formed might come crumbling down. So like a tsunami coming on the surface of the ocean. So if we are on the surface, we will be swept away. If we identify with our functional roles alone, if we identify that this is my functional identity and this is who I am, and tomorrow we can't do that, then we'll be destroyed. But if we do, we go deep in. Understand, yes, this is my functional identity. Yes, I am a doctor, I am an engineer. But that is only a part of who I am. Below all these, I am a soul. So understanding our functional identity gives us stability. Krishna says in the Bhagavad-gita that yam hi navyathayante te purusham purusharshabha samadukha sukham dhiram somrutatvaya kalpate. So yam hi navyathayante te navyathayante te, you will not be disturbed. Why? Because you will understand that you are a soul. Purusham purusharshabha samadukha sukham dhiram. Happiness and distress will come. Somrutatvaya kalpate. If you understand you are a soul, then, and you act accordingly, you will rise to the spiritual level of understanding. And then Krishna gives various frames of analysis to explain how actually we are souls. So, he says that avinashi tu tadviddhi yena sarvamidam tatam vinasham avyayasyasya nakashchit kartum arhati. There is something which pervades the whole body, and that is consciousness. Now, as soon as you talk about something like the soul, people start, we may get the question, hey, is that scientific? Is that scientific? Now yes, it's a good question to ask, but science is a particular way of looking at the world, and when science is the study of matter. The Bhagavad Gita is the study of what matters. Science is the study of matter. Okay, how do various material things interact with each other? Okay, this Newton saw that fruit falling. Some people say it fell in front of him, some people say it fell on him. And then, most people would just have picked up the fruit and eaten it and gone their way. But Newton asked, hey, what made this fruit fall? And then he came up with gravity. So it's a study of matter. And science is phenomenally effective in the study of matter. But the study of what matters, what is really important in life, that science doesn't tell us. Science is not moral, it is not immoral, it is amoral. Amoral means science can tell if some young boy is there and he has a grandmother who has a big mansion which she has given as inheritance to him. Now he knows science, by studying biology, studying chemistry, he can know that if I put arsenic in my grandmother's breakfast, I can get the inheritance faster. But should I do that or not do that? That science doesn't tell. Now this is not a deficiency of science, because science doesn't study that. Now, Einstein said that we can talk about the ethical foundation of science, but we can't talk about a scientific foundation of ethics. So ethics is something which it's very important for us to know what to do and what not to do. But how do we know that? We know that not by any scientifically measurable parameter. What is to be done? Science can tell us if you do this, this will happen, if you do this, this will happen. But the study of what matters, that is outside the domain of science. Say, nowadays, I recently gave a seminar on overcoming fear. So I did a study of different fears that people have had across different centuries. So what are the top 10 fears in the 18th century, 19th century, 20th century, 21st century? So in the 21st century, two fears have been added in the top 10 list. One is the fear of terrorists. And the second is the fear of rejection. Rejection. We form a relationship with someone and that person just rejects us and goes away. So now, that is a great, great fear when we are entering into a relationship. Is other person, does the other person really care for us? Now suppose a boy proposes to a girl, you know, I love you, please marry me. Now the girl can't take out a love-o-meter, let me put it on your heart to see, do you really love me? Now no matter how much scientific advancement we make, we cannot quantify love. This doesn't mean it is not real. Science studies mathematical measurable parameters. And it studies material interactions and material phenomena, but there is much that is beyond the arena of science. So is there scientific evidence for the soul? Or we can say that we can make inferences about it. But there is physical matter, there is subtle matter, and there is spirit. So physical matter is primarily what science studies. Subtle matter is what is beyond science. And spirit is entirely beyond science. So the soul is not against science. The soul is above science. Now, there is scientific evidence in the sense that where does consciousness come from? This is very difficult for people to understand. For even scientists to understand. I have written a book on reincarnation. And in that book, and I studied about, on the 125th anniversary of the Science magazine, they had 125 questions whose answer science doesn't have. The second question there was, where does consciousness come from? The second most unanswered question. The first unanswered question was, where does the universe come from? So where does universe come from and where does our consciousness come from? These are questions which are very difficult to answer. So now the Bhagavad Gita gives us a possible answer. It says consciousness comes from the soul. And if it comes from the soul, what is the practical implication of that? So Krishna gives characteristics of the soul. He says, Achedyoyam adhayoyam akledyoshoshevacha nityah sarvagatasthanur achaloyam sanatanaha. It's like if we have a particular object, we might want to know about its physics and chemistry. Says Krishna says, this cannot be dissolved, this cannot be burnt, this cannot be withered, this is indestructible. And now understanding ourselves as a soul gives us an internal level of security that no amount of financial security, social security, any kind of insurance can provide us. Because we understand as a soul, I am indestructible. So this is the central message that Krishna gives. Shift your identity. Understand that you are neither a Kshatriya nor you are a Kurandana. You are first and foremost a Atma, a soul. And as a soul, decide what is your function. So there Krishna says that Jatasya hi dhruvo mrityur dhruvam janma mrityasya cha, that everybody is going to die. And after everybody dies, they're going to be born again. So I talked earlier about scientific evidences. There is a lot of scientific study about past life memories. And in my book, I have got about 20-25 cases. So, Hare Krishna, what is your name? Sorry? Aradhya. Oh, and how old are you, Aradhya?
Six.
Oh, thank you. So, sometimes there are cases where a girl smaller than Aradhya, just 3 or 4 years old, suddenly she goes to her mother and says, Mom, where is my other mom? So, what? I said, no, my mom exists. She said, this is her name. She used to live here. And then there are cases where some kids have said, if you don't take me there, I am going alone over there. And then they start searching. And it's not just one or two. There are hundreds of cases like this across the world. And there are not just recollections. There are four levels of evidences. Recollections. Then there are recognitions. People go over there and they start to recognize this person. Oh, this is... Is so and so. I know you. This is my mother, this is my brother, this is my sister. Not only recognitions, there are behaviors. There are behaviors where people can understand that they recognize. Not only they recognize the person, but they behave accordingly. There's a case from Turkey. There was one man, Nasib Budak. When he was a young boy, he said that, and he says, I live in another city. He says, no, you live here. He says, no, his previous life also, his name was Nasib. And finally, when he was taken there, he actually went to that city and went straight to the house, although he had never been there. He led his grandfather, who had taken him there, to that house. And there was a woman who was a widow of one man named Nasib. And he recognized her. Now, this Nasib who had died, he had children who were older than him now, because he was a small 6-year-old boy. But when he saw them, he started fondling their hair and showing affection as if they were children. And then his widow, she had remarried now. So she had remarried. When he saw his previous life's wife's photo with some other man, he picked up that frame, the small one, wanted to throw it down. He said, "You are my wife, no one else's wife." So there were behaviors like that. And not only behaviors, perhaps the strongest evidences, there are also birthmarks and birth defects. So the Nasib had been an alcoholic, and once he had got in a drunken bout with someone, and the other person had stabbed him at multiple places. So he had been stabbed at multiple places and he had died at that time. So now this boy Nasib, he since his birth had birthmarks, and whenever he would remember his past lives, he would say, "Hey, no, this is where I was stabbed." And because he had been, it had been a murder case, there was post-mortem and report was there. So they found that the birthmarks from the previous, the birthmarks of this life and the fatal wounds of the previous life, there was exact correspondence between them. And how precise was the correspondence? So the researchers, to find that out, they divide the human body into 128 XY coordinates. And they locate at what point exactly is the correlation. And even one correlation would require 1 by 128 probability. And there are 6 correlating birthmarks. That is 1 by 128 raised to the power of 6. It's extremely low probability for so many correlations to come about. So basically, what Krishna says over here is that the soul is for real. The soul is who we are. And the soul dies, the person dies, but the soul leaves the body and goes to another body. And if the soul goes to the next body, at that time it continues its journey. Now, in the context of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is telling him that, "Oh Arjuna, first you understand who you are, then you will be able to decide what you should do." So, whenever, yeah?
Hare Krishna. I have one small doubt.
Yes, please.
I have seen a couple of cases like this where, you know, people remember their past things personally also.
Yeah.
But why is it that everybody can't remember their past life? Is it that we did not have any past life? Or,
oh, good question.
Or did they something in that life that they got the power, you know, to remember it in the next life?
Okay,
like
good
suppose
question.
Suppose if now I want to remember this life in my next life, if I have one, what do a person has to do?
Okay, yeah. Good question. So, why do some people remember their past lives? Why can't we remember? And if we want to remember, how can we remember?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, generally, every new life is an opportunity for the soul to begin a new chapter. And the normal or natural way of living is that each chapter is like a fresh chapter. So, what we have done in the past comes with us as impressions. Even if somebody is a parent and they have children, 2-3 children, each child has their own personality. And they're genetically the same parents are there, but still the personality is different. Even if you consider there are twins, and even identical twins, still identical twins are not identical. They're their personality. So basically, that personality, you could say at a subconscious level, is shaped by what we were in the previous lives. So, because each life is a new way to begin, is a new chapter in our evolution, so the normal way is that we forget. And if you consider that way, we have limited cognitive capacities. Even now, how much do you remember of something that happened 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago? We can't keep it all in the memory. So basically, to forget is our nature. And also, when we go through some traumatic experiences, then one way to cope with the trauma is by forgetting. Somebody has had some trauma and if they can't forget, then that repeated remembrance of the trauma is a bigger trauma. So death and then going to another place and taking birth again, these are not very pleasant incidents for the soul. So for the soul to not be traumatized by the past, nature arranges in most occasions for the memory to be lost. It's not exactly lost, it's buried deep within. So our existence is 3 levels, there's the body, there's the mind and the soul. So the body at death is left behind, and the soul along with the mind goes to the next body. So the mind contains the impressions, but often they get buried deep behind. Now usually when somebody remembers the past lives, it's because the soul has not been able to process the event of death. When death happens suddenly, like somebody dies because of a murderous attack, or somebody dies very young, somebody dies because of some sudden accident, then what happens? The soul leaves the body, but the event has happened so fast that the soul has not processed it. Just like, say, if you come from India to America, then the body has a jet lag. Isn't it? The biological clock is still in India, whereas physically we have come to America. So similarly, we could say there is a soul lag. So the soul, the consciousness is still in there in the previous body, but the soul has physically come into this body. And so usually this happens when the person has died sudden death, or if there is something in the stimuli in this life which reminds the soul of the previous life. What is this? I want to remember this. And most of the children who remember those previous lives, they are very insistent. I want to go there, meet this person. And when they go and meet, then there is an emotional closure. And most of these people, when they grow older, they may remember their previous lives. And sometimes they maintain connections also with the previous life. But that emotional intensity is not there. So they need a sense of closure. Okay, this chapter in my life is over. Now this chapter will begin. So that's why most of us don't remember, because it's for us for a progressive evolution. And some people remember because of the not having processed the event of death. And as far as can we remember, there are some ways to remember. There is called something called hypnotically induced past life regression. That means hypnosis is a way by which our conscious mind is calmed down, and then our thoughts can be directed toward a particular direction. So now sometimes there are trained regressors who can take us back to our childhood, to our early childhood, and some of them can take us back to previous lives also. Now the problem with this is that in the state of hypnosis, we are in a very receptive stage. So then what we perceive at that time, whether it is an authentic recollection coming from our consciousness or whether it is a suggestion from the regressor which is induced in imagination, it's difficult to know that. So that's a serious, although there have been a lot of cases of people who had some trauma. Say somebody has hydrophobia, just become paranoid when they go near water. Then by hypnotic regression, they are taken to a previous life, and then they remember, oh, I had drowned in water in my previous life. And then that helps them, okay, this is why I had that fear. Once then that helps them to become healed of that fear. So Dr. Brian Weiss is a prominent researcher, and he followed, and many others have followed after that. He's an Ivy League doctor, and he has been able to heal many people of psychosis that were not treatable by normal conventional means. Now, having said that, even if somebody is healed, there is no guarantee that that necessarily means that the event was real. It could also be that it's like the way placebos work. Placebo, the patient gets healed, although they're just given sugar pills. So the mind feels, oh, I'm getting medicated, I'm getting healed. So they get healed. So that's why hypnotically regressed memories, how authentic they are, that's open to question. Now there are some cases, and I have documented them in my book, where during hypnotic regression, some of the subjects exhibit xenoglossy and xenography. Xenoglossy is the knowledge of foreign languages, speaking. And xenography is writing it. So there is one case, one person named Marcus, he actually wrote in a script that existed 1800 years ago. And there are only about 6 or 7 people in the world who even know that script. And he had no contact with that. And initially, he, when he was conscious, he said, this is just gibberish. But his hypnotic regressor thought, maybe there's something over here. Because it looked like scrawl, but it had been written like systematically written scrawl. So then he had to go to that language expert, and they found that this is actually written a script. And he correspondingly remembered those lines also. So by hypnotic regression, it is possible to remember, but how authentic it is, we can't know for sure. And there have been a few cases where people get haunted by what they consider to be their past life memories. That's why the mainstream researcher, Ian Stevenson, is the main researcher in this field. He said so he studied only spontaneous past life memories, not hypnotically induced. Because in hypnotically induced, you can't know whether it's a suggestion or it's a recollection. But spontaneously induced means the child suddenly on them, their own says that. And what purpose will it serve? Even if you remember our past lives, maybe you could say, okay, that will convince me I am a soul. That will inspire me to move forward spiritually. Well, after I wrote my book, I again did some study. And these boys and girls who remembered their previous lives, none of them became more spiritual because they remembered their past lives. Yes, I was a soul. I had a previous life. Now I am living in this life. In fact, one of the most perhaps well-known cases, you could say, was of Thomas Andrews, who became William Barnes. Thomas Andrews was one of the main designers of the Titanic ship. And when the Titanic sank, he was blamed that the design was faulty. There was another, Jonathan Black, he was the main financier for that. Or he was the main arranger of the finances. So he survived, and Andrews sank along with the Titanic. Now later on, another person named William Barnes, he was born and he said, I am the reincarnation of Thomas Andrews. And he gave one of the best explanations available till now about why the Titanic sank so quickly. Because the Titanic was hit by an iceberg, but before rescue could reach, it sank. So he said that actually the ship was made of metal. And when he had been testing the ship before the maiden launch, at that time he had been testing the ship by hitting it with a hammer at various points on the hull. And at one particular point, he hit it, resonance started. And then he told Black that actually, at these points, this is vulnerable. Because if a resonance occurs, if there's collision and resonance crack, then multiple places it may crack. So we need to thicken the hull. So Black said, no, now we don't have time for it. And then he pushed it aside. So basically, when the iceberg hit it, when it was hit by that solid snow, it triggered resonance. And that's why it cracked at multiple places. So anyway, Barnes also has many accurate memories of what all events transpired over there. But although Barnes has these accurate memories and he has got a reasonable theory to explain the sinking of the Titanic, Barnes has no interest in understanding his own spirituality. He says, I want to prove that I am Thomas Andrews reincarnated so that I can clear the good name of Thomas Andrews. That's his purpose. So in that sense, he said, Andrews was an honest man, but Black smeared his reputation. And I want to clear his good name. So in that sense, even remembering a past life may not necessarily orient one spiritually. So if nature gives some people some memories, that's fine. Have they consciously done something? Well, I have interacted with a few children who remember their past lives. And for us, when we hear somebody remember their past lives, it's sensational. It's like, aaj ki taza khabar. You know, it's like breaking news. But for those children, it is quite disorienting. Who am I? And it's not a pleasant experience for them. So it's some peculiar combination of factors that might cause some children to remember. So if nature has not given us that memory, then it means that for our evolution, we don't need that memory of previous lives. Okay?
ISKCON also, Bhakti Charu Maharaj's disciple, Ratnavali, was Raghava Pandit.
Yeah, there's a case. That is a good case of. We have also had some devotees who have had some recollections of previous lives.
Is it like sometimes, you know, some incidents happen and we feel that, okay, this happened somewhere else. Like, I'm sure
that's
it
true.
Would have happened with many of us. Like, sometimes
that's
one
true.
Incident happened, you think that exactly the same way it happened somewhere else.
Yeah, that's called deja vu. So deja vu, when it happens, how or what exactly is happening? That's multiple things could be possible. So that is, broadly, our memory is a very mysterious tool. That means, what all we remember and what all we forget, sometimes it's not so easy to reason it out. Sometimes we see some person after 35 years, maybe some of you may not be 35 years old also, but we see somebody after 35 years and we remember, I had lent this person $5, he did not give it back to me. That might be the first thing we may remember. It's not that we are so stingy or greedy or something like that. See, what we will remember, it's mystery. It's not so straightforward. So basically, when we feel I have been in a particular situation, at one level it could be that we have been in some other situation, but some stimuli from the situation reminds us of that situation, or is similar to that situation. Now, because this is also one stimuli and the other factors of that situation were very different, that's why we are not able to exactly go forward. Okay, when was I here? You know, I've done this before, or I've seen this before, I've been here before. So it could be just a generic recollection triggered by a specific stimulus. Another possibility could be that sometimes some people have prescient dreams. That means prescience is to know in advance, and some people may have some dreams, and according to researchers, again, dream is a very complex phenomena in the sense that a very small percentage of the dreams that we have, we remember them consciously. So sometimes we might have had a prescient dream, and then when the situation comes, it's like, okay, I've been here, when was I? Because we don't recollect that dream, so we can't remember when it happened. But we had that some recollection of that in the dream. And a third possibility could also be, as you rightly hinted at, that we might have been in a similar situation in the previous life. So deja vu for some people who go through it can be a very transformative experience. But it would not be necessarily pointing to one particular conclusion objectively. Okay, thank you. So any other questions? Okay, so I'll complete this second chapter and we can continue some questions. Thank you for your good questions.
Thank you.
So, now in the second chapter, I discussed till about verse 30. So first, Arjuna asks, what is the right thing to do? And Krishna says, before you understand the question, understand who you are. It takes him from his fundamental identity to his foundational identity. Sorry, from his functional identity to his foundational or fundamental identity. And then, knowledge is always to be applied. And the same knowledge can be applied at different levels. That means, if somebody knows how to cook, now they can cook food which can last for maybe for the next meal, like 2-3 hours. Or they can cook a food which can last for the next 3-4 days. So the knowledge can be applied at different levels. Somebody may have medical knowledge and they may use that to treat a series of patients and they earn some money by that. Or they may use that knowledge to do some humanitarian work. They may not get some immediate result by that, but they may get a deeper sense of fulfillment and value by that. So Krishna also, this knowledge of the soul, he talks about applying it at different levels. So first he says to Arjuna that, oh Arjuna, if you understand you are eternal, then in this war, if you fight and you win, then you will get the kingdom over here. Hato va prapsisi swargam jitva va bhongshase mahim tasmat uttishta kaunteya yuddhaya krutanishchaya. In 237 he says, therefore Arjuna, rise and fight. If you win, you will get this kingdom. If you lose, you will die honorably fighting. And if you die honorably fighting, you as a soul are eternal, and because you have died honorably, you will rise to a higher level. You will attain the heavenly kingdom. So therefore, either you win or lose, you will gain. And here Krishna talks about going to a higher level of reality, that is a heavenly level of reality. But after this, so Krishna speaks this, and here he talks in at the level of punya. Punya is where we do good and we get good back. Now that can be done in a short term, that can be a long term, it can be done a much longer term. So that we do good means we do something good for someone and they do something good back for us. That's one simple way of punya might work. But we do good and then we go to swarga. So going to swarga is like a person working very hard and saving a lot to go to stay at a resort. Now, if somebody has saved a lot, they can stay at a resort for a long time. But every day they are staying at the resort, their balance is dwindling. And once their balance gets over, they will no longer be allowed to stay at the resort. So like that, going to the heavens are wonderful, in a sense there is a lot of pleasure over there. But heavens are also temporary. Because heaven is also a material place. It's like going to a resort, and if you do adequate punya, punya is like a bank balance. So we have the punya balance, we'll go to heaven. But once the punya balance is exhausted, then we'll come back again. So then Krishna says, okay, so yes, you understand you are a soul, then you can, even if you die, you'll go to heaven. So you keep fighting. But then he says, okay, but even heaven, it might be better than here, it might be longer than here, but even then it is temporary, where the soul is eternal. Therefore, strive for something eternal. And then he talks about how the soul is meant. So the Bhagavad-gita talks about a multi-level cosmos. We are at the terrestrial, earthly level. Below that is the subterranean, the hellish level. Above this is the heavenly level. But beyond this is the spiritual level. So he says, act in a way that you will raise yourself in spiritual consciousness. And that's where the well-known verse comes in. Karmanyevadhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana ma karma phala heturbhur ma te sangostva karmani. At work, but without attachment to the fruits. Now somebody may ask, what is the point of working if I work for the fruits? A student works to get marks. We do our job to get a salary. Somebody who is a owner of a company, say, if people don't work for the fruits, I can get a lot of profit myself. And everybody will just work without fruits. Krishna is not saying work without fruits. He's saying work without attachment to the fruits. What is the point of that? Work for something bigger than the fruits. Like a student can study for gaining marks. Or a student can study to gain mastery of the subject. Now, when the student gets mastery of the subject, they will also get marks. But if the purpose is only to get marks, they will get the marks, but they will not have much knowledge about the subject. So Krishna is, when he says, Krishna says, work without attachment to the fruits, that means, not that you don't care for the fruits, but care for something bigger than the fruits. And what is that? Every action that we do, it has two levels of reactions. One is outer, we get some result. But there is an inner reaction. Inner reaction is every action shapes us into something. Say somebody drinks alcohol. They drink alcohol or they take drugs. Now once they take the drug, there will be a physical reaction to that. But there is also a reaction in terms of they start developing the habit of taking drugs. So for every action, there is an external reaction and there is an internal reaction. And when we act with detachment, that means when we act with spiritual consciousness for a spiritual purpose, then the inner impressions that are created, they spiritualize our consciousness. So working with detachment means don't just be caught. If I do this, will I get this result? If I do this, I won't get this result. Okay, that's important. But there's something more important than that. Work to develop your consciousness. Work to raise your consciousness to the spiritual level. So a student who works to, see, there could be, I work for marks, work to learn the subject, work to develop an educated mind. Now, yes, you can study a subject and gain knowledge of the subject, that's excellent. But if somebody develops an educated mind, then they can study any subject in the future. The purpose of education in that sense could be multi-level. It is to get marks, it is to gain mastery of the subject, it is to gain an educated mind. Similarly, when we work, we can work to earn money. We can work to develop our career. But we can work to develop our consciousness. We can work to become a more evolved human being. So this again goes back to acting according to our fundamental identity. If I understand I'm a soul, and a soul is meant to act in a mood of service in all situations. We act in that way, every one of us, in whatever situation we are in, we can be elevated. We can grow. Sometimes, there seems to be no success possible in a particular situation. And we can get very disheartened. But there is no option to, we can't even give up that activity. We just have to do it. But there doesn't seem to be, nothing is going to improve, but we have to keep doing it. We become very disheartened. Why should I keep doing it? But if you are obliged to do that, say, okay, nothing may improve externally, but if I keep doing it in the mood of service, in a mood of spiritual consciousness, I will evolve spiritually. And thus, even in situations that don't look good, we can look for good in those situations. The situations may not themselves look good, but still, we can look for and find some good in those situations. And then, when Krishna talks about all this, this brings us to the last section of the Bhagavad-gītā, where Arjuna asks, Krishna, you're talking about this person who will work with detachment, who will not be attached to the results. So he is thinking, does this mean, will such a person fight a war? He's working with detachment, what will such a person do? So he asks a question, that sthita pragyasya ka bhasha samadhisthasya keshava siddhi kim prabhasheta kim asita vrajeta kim. What are the characteristics of such a person? How does that person speak? How does that person walk? How does that person sit? Now the Bhagavad Gita is poetry. So it's a Gita, poetry. Poetry means there's a lot of indicative or metaphorical usage. Now when there's a serious philosophical discussion between Krishna and Arjuna, Arjuna is obviously not asking how does this person walk. He's not asking does a person walk like a some model white walk on a fashion ramp. That's not his question. Walk means how does the person function in the world. Sit means how does the person restrain oneself. How does the person talk means how does the person respond to life's ups and downs. We can all talk nicely in normal situations, but when we are provoked, when some difficulties come up, then often all the things that we keep hidden start coming out. One of my friends is in the espionage business. Now he was a spy. So he was trained to be a spy. So he had to go. He was supposed to go and be a spy in Pakistan. So he had learned Urdu, and he told me one of his tests was that when he was sleeping, his supervisor came and kicked him suddenly, and then normally if somebody comes and kicks us, we'll yell or we'll curse. So his supervisor told him, I want to test whether you curse in Hindi or in Urdu. So if you want to be a spy to that level, that consciousness has to get assimilated within you. So similarly, how we speak means normally you can speak very nicely and politely, but when somebody comes and kicks us, somebody life kicks us, how do we speak? So Krishna is asked by Arjuna, what are the symptoms of a spiritually realized person? And then from 55 to 72 is the last time Krishna describes the characteristics of a spiritually evolved person. And essentially, he says that such a person is not disturbed by life's dualities. So, I'll give one metaphor that is used over there. For illustrating this point, that Krishna says in 270 in the Bhagavad-gītā, āpūryamānam achala pratiṣṭham samudramāpa pravishanti yadvad tadvat kāmāyam pravishanti sarve sa shantim āpnoti na kāma kāmi. So he says that just as water flows into an ocean, rivers flow into an ocean, but the ocean is not disturbed. Similarly, desires, stimuli flow into the consciousness of a spiritually realized person, but that person is not disturbed. Now, to understand what this verse actually means, practically speaking, we can compare, say, instead of an ocean, if a river flows into a small puddle. In a puddle, if the river flows, everything will overflow and there will be devastation. So similarly, our consciousness can either be like a puddle or it can be like an ocean. Now, the size of our consciousness is determined by what is present within it, what it is that we are attached to. If what we are attached to is a very small thing, so if we are attached to something very small, then a small disturbance can make us very angry. If somebody is, say, attached to, I was once going on a train in India, and at that time, I saw in the distance, as devotees sometimes, we often wear a bead bag because we chant our mantras. So I saw somebody sitting ahead, walking, standing ahead, and that person had a bead bag. I said, oh, that is nice to meet a devotee. So I went and approached him. So I asked him, how were you introduced to Bhagavad Gita, to Bhakti? He says, what Bhagavad Gita? I said, isn't this a bead bag? Don't touch it! I said, what? He said, don't touch it. It is my nail bag. What? He said, I am contesting for the Guinness Book of World Records for the longest nail in the world. And he had his long nail which had stored in the bag. So that looked like a bead bag. So he was in this train, and anybody who touched that nail, don't touch this. Because if the nail breaks, my years of work will go away.
That's how the girls react when they put mehendi.
Yeah. So anyway, so if somebody's consciousness is consumed with nails, then a small touch of the back can agitate them a lot. So the consciousness is like a puddle. Small thing can agitate them. You will see sometimes some people, you know, small things, we ask them, oh, why did you come late? Why are you nagging me? So if they're just, their consciousness is caught in small things, and a small provoking also, overreaction comes up. But if somebody's consciousness is like an ocean, then it's like whatever provocation comes up, it's like a river coming into it. So if God is present in our consciousness, if our consciousness is spiritually focused on God and our relationship with Him as souls, the soul is indestructible, God is also indestructible. And the soul is connected with God, then that brings a security that is not easily disturbed. So both kind of provocations can come. Sometimes temptations can provoke us. Sometimes troubles can provoke us. But if our consciousness has become like an ocean, then we will not be provoked. We will not get so easily disturbed. And the whole message of the Bhagavad Gita is, in a sense, how to expand our consciousness, so that it will become like an ocean. And when it has become like an ocean, we can go through life's journey without being disturbed. So indirectly, Krishna is telling Arjuna that right now your consciousness is like a puddle. That's why when you are facing this ethical dilemma, you are confused, you are disoriented. But if you expand your consciousness and understand yourself spiritually, connect yourself with the Supreme Spiritual Reality, then you will not be so disturbed. And not only will you stay undisturbed in life, you will stay undisturbed even at death. Esha te brahmi sthiti partha nainam prapya vimohyati sthitva asyam antakalepi brahma nirvanam richati. Krishna says, if you are situated like this throughout your life, then you will be similarly situated at the time of death, and then you will go beyond the world of birth and death. If your consciousness is attached to the divine, then at the end of death, you attain the divine. When we die, we leave home and our body goes to a crematorium or wherever. But for the soul who is attached to God by spiritual practice, the consciousness expands. That soul at death doesn't leave home. That soul goes home. Because home is where the ones who we love are. So if during our life journey we have developed our love for God, then when we leave, when we die, when we leave this body, we may leave our physical home, but we go to our spiritual home. And that journey, the path for that journey, the process for that journey is what the Bhagavad-gita will describe in its onward flow. So I'll summarize the second chapter as we discuss today, and then we can have a few questions. So the second question begins with a universal human question: what is the right thing to do? And during the normal course of life, it's like we are driving on a straight road. We may not get the question, yeah, this I have to do, this I have to do this. But when life puts us at an intersection, then, oh, what am I to do? So Arjuna is put at an intersection based on, should I fight or should I not fight? It's like a judge. Should I judge this person or not? But the person is my son. So what we should do is determined by who we think we are. So two roles can pull the judge, as a father and as a judge, in two different directions. So Arjuna is pulled in two different directions by his identity as a Kshatriya and his identity as a Kurunandana. It's Kshatriya Dharma and Kula Dharma. To resolve this tension, Krishna tells you have to go to your, beyond your functional identities, to your fundamental identity. You are a soul, a part of God. And you go deep to that level, then storms or agitation at the surface level won't disturb. Like the person who was in the tsunami, but below, the scuba divers, they were not devastated. So we will also, when we become situated at a spiritual level, life storms won't disturb us so much. Krishna, then we talked about how is there scientific evidence for the soul? Because yes and no. No in the sense that science is the study of matter. Scripture is the study of what matters. There are questions beyond science, because science studies basically material interaction between things. But even within the material interaction of things, we can get some inferences which point towards the existence of the soul. And we talked about past life memories and why some of us remember, why few of us remember, most of us forget. And then after that, knowledge has to be translated into action. So Krishna gives two levels of action. First is, okay, you know you are a soul, therefore don't worry about dying over here. Even if you die, you will go to heaven. That's one level. But then even heaven is like going to a resort based on the savings you have made. Savings will end and our stay in the resort will also end. Like that, heaven is also temporary. So then Krishna says, if you are a soul, aim for not just a destination beyond this world, beyond this life, but beyond this temporary world, aim for an eternal destination. And to aim to get that, should work with detachment. Now, working with detachment doesn't mean we don't care for the fruits. We care for something bigger than the fruits. Like a student who studies, not just for gaining the marks or gaining mastery of the subject, but for developing an educated mind. So we work not just to get the results, but to develop our consciousness. Every work has an external consequence and an internal consequence. So if we work with spiritual consciousness, then we grow spiritually. And the last part from 54 to 72 talks about what are the characteristics of a self-realized person. So here the Bhagavad-gita uses non-literal language to talk about how somebody walks, somebody talks, that means how they conduct themselves in life, how they respond to life's dualities, how they regulate themselves. And I discuss one aspect of Krishna's answer, that such people are undisturbed by life's ups and downs. And that happens because their consciousness is expanded. A river coming into a puddle will disrupt, a river coming into ocean will not disrupt. So our consciousness may currently be like a puddle, that's why we get disturbed by many small things. But by the process of spirituality as described in the Bhagavad-gita, our consciousness can expand. The size of the consciousness depends on the size of the prominent object of attachment for us. So when we become attached to the biggest reality, that is God, then our consciousness becomes expansive like an ocean. And for one who is attached to God, they can live without being too disturbed by life's ups and downs. And eventually at death, they don't leave home, but they go home to be with God. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So any questions or comments? Any comments?
You mentioned about science is the study of matter. When Srila Prabhupada went to MIT, he said, I don't need it. I'm yelling. he asked him, he saw all the departments of knowledge. Where is your department of knowledge to study the soul? You don't have any things to study the soul. So I guess even there, he's saying somehow we should try and understand the soul. I mean, even consciousness or thinking, you know, it's like, how do you think? How does it work? We know we do it, but how does it work? So they try to study that. They should study the soul.
Yes, definitely. Science, Prabhupada said that he went to MIT, where is the department for the study of the soul? Yeah, that's what happened in the start of science itself. The prominent scientists, they divided, because the world around us is extremely complex. So they divided the world we observe into two qualities, primary qualities and secondary qualities. And they said, now how did they decide what is primary and what is secondary? Those which are measurable or quantifiable, they call as primary qualities. And those which are non-quantifiable, they call as secondary qualities. So for example, length, breadth, velocity, mass, density, all these are measurable. Now, beauty, fragrance, taste, love, these are all non-quantifiable. Now, in our experience, when we look at it, for us, primary is not the, you go for a program and says, I met a very, very interesting person today. Oh, really? Tell me about the person. He says, he's 5 feet 9 inches. Really? Is that interesting? So when we look at the world, the measure, mathematical measure, is not usually the primary thing that we see. But because that's measurable, that's quantifiable, so what science considers as primary is different from what we in our we experience as primary. So initially it was understood that what science considers secondary properties, they're also important and they should also be studied. But over a period of time, as science started getting more and more success in studying the primary properties and changing things in the outer world by the study of those primary properties, they started getting the idea that the secondary properties can all be reduced to primary properties. Or the secondary properties are what they call as epiphenomena. They don't have any fundamental existence in themselves. And that's why the idea now, is science studying consciousness? Yes, it is trying to by reducing consciousness to brain phenomena. Now, in the brain, definitely something happens whenever we do anything. So when we laugh, to give a very simplified example, when we laugh, maybe a certain part of the brain is activated. Maybe when we pray, a certain part of the brain is activated. When we are angry, a certain part of the brain is activated. That's all true. But the brain ultimately is simply chemicals. It's brain cells which are in which certain chemicals are flowing. So there's no experience happening in the brain. The experiencer exists outside the brain. So Now, Prabhupada used the word science in a very inclusive sense to refer to any systematic body of knowledge. And in that sense, we could say Bhagavad Gita also is science. Spirituality is a science. Bhakti Yoga is a science because it is a systematic body of knowledge, and it is a systematic body of knowledge where you can, to some extent, have repeatability and predictability. That if somebody follows the process of bhakti, their consciousness will expand. They will become stronger in terms of resisting temptations, resisting tribulations. It's predictable and it's also repeatable. It's happened for thousands of people across the world. So in that sense, this is also a science. So Prabhupada used science in that inclusive sense. Today, mainstream science largely works in that narrower sense of what they call as methodological naturalism, that we will study only natural phenomena and explain them in natural terms. Natural means material terms, and material terms means the what they consider primary properties. So it's especially consciousness is the field where science is. There are many scientists who are becoming more and more open to a non-reductionistic paradigm, saying consciousness just can't be explained in physical terms. It's certain areas of the brain may be activated when we experience certain emotions, but that is correlation, that is not causation. That means, say when we are happy, now we smile. Now we can find out by a scientific study, okay, how are a person's muscles when they smile? Now somebody can put a plastic like a secretary smile. Now you could go further and you could get a machine which will twist your face. And we smile. Now a smile is the result of happiness. A smile is itself not happiness, and a smile itself is not necessarily the cause of happiness internally. So smile is the physical result of an inner experience called happiness. So similarly, now of course you could say sometimes that when somebody is very glum and depressed, come on, cheer up. And you smile, you will feel a little better. But there are limits to that. If somebody is having hundreds of problems in their life, you just tell them smile. Say for example, I'm sitting on this chair. And suppose this chair, the seat below is filled with thorns. And somebody says, come on, smile. Now, that smile is not going to have much utility. So, there is consciousness as an irreducible reality. What antidepressants and some things like that do? Okay, certain chemicals are less in the brain because of which you're feeling depressed. You inject those chemicals and then your depression will go away. Yes, it can go away, and in some cases where chemical deficiency is there, you inject the inject those chemicals, depression may go down. But if there are depressing situations in a person's life which are not being dealt with, if their relationships are in disarray, their career is in disarray, their habits are terrible, then just pumping chemicals into the brain is not going to remove depression. So similarly, trying to reduce the brain, reduce all our human experiences to brain phenomena is like reducing happiness to a smile. It's a part of it, but it's an external part of it. So science, at least there are a good number of scientists who are recognizing that our conscious experience is not something which is reducible to brain phenomena, and that's where it's likely that science will recognize something non-material. Okay, thank you. Any other question? Yes, please. Hare Krishna.
I have a question, but it's not directly related to second chapter. Could I still ask?
Okay, sure. Does anyone else have questions related to the second chapter? Okay, sure.
So my understanding is that as for most of the Vedic literature, Krishna is the Supreme Lord, and except Lord Chaitanya, every other incarnations are his portion and portions of portions, right? So that's one part. And second part is there are four yugas. Mm-hmm. And out of four yogas, like Kali Yoga is the least amount, has the least amount of days. And Krishna even doesn't come in every Kali Yoga, neither Lord Chaitanya. They come in every four circles.
Okay, yeah.
So that means like only like every in one in four Kali Yuga people will be worshipping Lord Krishna, Lord Chaitanya. So if he's the Supreme Lord, so why is that, you know, people of other time are not directly worshipping his Krishna form?
Okay. So if Krishna is the original manifestation of God, then he comes rarely in the cosmic cycles. Why do other people not worship him? We could say that applies even when Krishna comes. So right now Krishna came or Lord Chaitanya came, but how many people are worshipping him? Right now also, what to speak of when he doesn't come? See, the idea is that mama vartamanu vartante manushya partha sarvasha. In 4.11 in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that all people are on my path. But what this means is, ye thamam prapadyante tam sathaiva bhajamyam. As all peoples are under unto me, I reciprocate with them accordingly. This means that God gives us different ways of moving forward in our spiritual journey based on our level and the spiritual path. So for different people, based on their current conceptions, there can be different ways in which they can move forward. And everybody is given revelations or guidance which can help them to move on from where they are. Religions are meant for God. God is not meant for religion. That's why Krishna says, Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam braj. So no religion has monopoly on God. Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives the example that if you see a big mountain peak, say like the Everest, different people may see it differently from different directions. And based on how they see it, they may describe it. Not only describe it, they may pursue it. Now a person coming to the Everest from the east, they may experience a path that is quite different where somebody is coming from the west. And they will write their experiences. So you could say that the top of the mountain is like God consciousness, spiritual consciousness, pure spiritual consciousness. And everywhere along the mountain is various levels of consciousness. The bottom of the mountain could say is material consciousness. So different people are on that mountain along different paths. So based on where they are, they will conceive the absolute, not entirely differently, but there will be some significant differences. And based on where they are given a vision by which they can move forward. So, Krishna doesn't insist that the whole bhakti tradition or the dharmic tradition is such that it gives people scope to move forward from where they are in their own way. So, that's why it's a very inclusive tradition. So, the way I put it is that from your place, at your pace, access the grace. So from your place, this is a big, big mountain, and we're coming up the mountain from different places. So from your place, at your pace, some people want to run straight towards the peak of the mountain. Some people, okay, I want to do some sightseeing also along the way. I'll go there, at your pace, access the grace. So it's an inclusive way of approaching the absolute truth, and that's why there are different conceptions of God, not just within the dharmic traditions, outside the bhakti tradition, the dharmic traditions also. And people all move on that journey of spiritual evolution according to where they are presently. Okay? Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
So at the time of death, Prabhu, it's very important that we think about Krishna, but even if we say have a headache or any ache in the body, we constantly think of that ache and that time if you analyze it, you may not remember Krishna because that's bothering you. So death is much more worse than a simple ache in the body. So if you don't think of Krishna at that time, or if you think of Krishna at that time, is it mercy of Krishna that you're able to think of him? And how much weight is there to think of Krishna? And say if you worked all your life and you did some service to Krishna, would that be counted towards, say, going back to
Yeah, okay. The
thought of Krishna at the end of your time is
yes. So now it's very difficult to remember Krishna, and even in Spain, in our normal lives, what to speak of at the time of death. So, if we are not able to remember at that time, then what we have remembered in throughout the life, will that count? Yes, of course. See, here, when Krishna talks about remembrance, it is not in terms of an intellectual recollection. It's like, how much is 23 into 23? It's not that kind of factual recollection. The recollection which Krishna is talking about is recollection based on affection. It's like you see someone, and if you meet an old friend after a long time, then we remember, oh, you know, we went there, we talked this, we did that. So Krishna is talking not of a factual or an intellectual recollection. He's talking about a personal recollection. And that comes from a personal relationship. So the whole point of when Krishna says, you remember me at the time of death, it's not an intellectual exercise based on the expertise in factual recollection. It's a personal relationship which leads to recollection based on affection. And let's put it the opposite way now. That means, suppose somebody has not remembered Krishna throughout their life. And they read in the Bhagavad-gītā that if you remember Krishna at the time of death, you will attain Krishna. So they live materialistically, and then they decide, now I had enough of living, so they put a gun on their forehead, Hare Krishna! And they press the trigger. Now, will they attain Krishna? They may say Hare Krishna, but their heart is not in Krishna at all. So even if they are able to utter the words at that time, that's not of... It's okay, it's better than just dying without remembering Krishna. But it's not a matter of simply recollecting at that moment. It's a matter of redirecting our heart towards Him. And if somebody has redirected their heart, now death, how it will come, we don't know. Say if somebody dies in coma, then you can't even know exact moment, because sometimes like the life support is there. So when does the person actually leave the body? It may be very difficult to know. So it's not that the relationship with Krishna is based on such technicalities. The important principle is we take responsibility to develop our relationship with Krishna as much as we can. And if we do our part, Krishna will do His part. Krishna and Jiva Goswami talks about two kinds of remembrances. His one is called as in Smriti and the other is Spurti. Smriti is cultivated or conscientious remembrance. That is what we try to do in sadhana bhakti. We try to fix the mind on Krishna's holiness when we do japa, when we do puja, when we do katha like this. And there is spontaneous recollection. That means suddenly the remembrance rises. Some days we may participate in some kirtan and suddenly we feel something spiritual. Or we go and take some darshan and we feel something special over there. Heart starts flowing towards the Lord. So that is Spurti. So, Smriti or cultivated remembrance, that is what we try to do by our sadhana bhakti practice. And Spurti is what comes by grace. So whether we are able to do Smriti, cultivated remembrance at the time of death or not, that is not as important. If we have done it throughout our life, then Krishna will give us Spurti at the time of death. Ramacharya asked this to Varadaraj through his guru, Kanchipurna. What if I am not able to remember you at the time of death? Then Varadaraj is the form of the Lord. Varadaraj replied that, you know, if you don't remember me at the time of death, I will remember you at the time of death. And I will come in your consciousness. And I will give you remembrance. So we focus on doing what is in our power. And Krishna will take care of the things that are beyond our power. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
So we heard of the pastime of Ajamil fit into what you just explained. There was no remembrance.
Okay.
It was just an utterance of the word.
Okay, so how does the pastime of Ajamil fit in? Ajamil is a story given in the 6th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam where there was a Brahmanical, very pious person, devoted person who became involved in very grievously wrong activities, and at the time of his death he had named one of his son Narayan, and he, when he was about to die, he called out to Narayan, And then the Vishnudutas came and saved him from the Yamadutas. And he got a second chance. So one of Srila Prabhupada's books is named Second Chance. So that's the background for those who don't know. Now, if you consider, our Acharya described exactly what happened. Now, when he said the name Narayana, initially he was calling out, he said, Narayana. But as he was uttering that name Narayana, he realized, this boy, what can he do for me? He can't help. And then as he uttered the name Narayana, he remembered the Narayana, him whom he had worshipped in his childhood and youth, but whom he had later turned away from. So that was, he did not chant with the intention of remembering Narayana as God. But when the action happened, because of the past habit, the action led to the recollection. And then because of that recollection, the Vishnutas came. But it's not that he went back to God at that time. He was saved at that time from going down to the hellish levels of reality. But he got a second chance, and then he took that second chance and he practiced diligently. So the basic principle of this is that if we have practiced bhakti, it will not be lost. But that doesn't mean that just by unintentional chanting, one will get purified of all sins and develop love for God. See, one may even be purified. But ultimately, unless we develop love for God, we won't even want to go back to God. See, even if somehow Krishna takes us to his abode, and there everybody loves Krishna, everybody wants to talk about Krishna. And there we want it. What's happening between India and Pakistan right now? See, if our interests are in politics, in sports, in movies, then even if we go there, we'll be out of place over there. So, if you practice bhakti, that will definitely stay with our credits. But unless our desire for Krishna is at the very least more than our desire for the world, we may not give up all worldly desires. But if at least our desire for Krishna is more than the desire for the world, then Krishna will take us out of the world. But if that is not the case, then Krishna will let us continue in the world, either in this life or another life, where we can strengthen our desire for Him. But if we have remembered Him, that will never be lost. He will remember it and He will give us further facilities to remember Him. Thank you. So thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki, Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Tai Gaur Premanande.
His Grace Chaitanya Charan Prabhu ki,
Jai.
Prabhupada ki.